Hello, I'm Pastor Paul Brown with First Independent Methodist Church here in Dublin. We would like to extend a special invitation for you to join us every Sunday at 10 a.m. for Sunday school, 11 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. for worship service. We also have two Bible studies every Wednesday at 3 and 7 p.m. At First Independent Methodist Church, you'll be a part of a caring and loving church family who want to share the love of Christ with you. We have something going on for all ages, whether it be our children's church, our wonderful youth program, Sisters in Christ, our men's ministry, or one of our Bible studies. We are so excited about what God is doing at FIMC. Also, please tune in to our services every Saturday night at 8 p.m. here on TV 35. We look forward to seeing you this Sunday at First Independent Methodist Church on Claxtonbury Road and Cardinal Drive. I pray that you will come and be a part of our family this week.
Can't think of a better place to be on a Sunday night than in church. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 tonight. Have you enjoyed the first two chapters?
Yes.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's been kind of. Boy, I can't wait till we get over there to that part and we start talking about Jesus. Huh? It's kind of depressing sometimes by this senior pastor who has written this book. And, you know, it's, I find it interesting because I saw someone today while we were at lunch that's been a family friend of ours for quite some time. And when I say that, I really mean for quite some time. I've known her since I was four. That's when we moved to Dublin. That's been 46 years, and she was not a spring chicken when I knew her, first met her. So, but anyway, she just mentioned to me, she said, you know, the older we get, the harder life becomes. And I have to agree with that. The older we get, the more challenges we seem to face on a daily basis. But as we look at chapter 3, we're going to look at the first 15 verses tonight, hopefully. Never can tell. We may get through them in a hurry, or we may get through them in a long time. But Solomon writes this, beginning in verse 1, "To everything there is a season and a time to every purpose under the heaven. A time to be born, time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill, and a time to heal, a time to break down, a time to build up, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to cast away. A time to rent and a time to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time of war and a time of peace. What profit hath he that worketh in that wherein he laboreth? I have seen the travail which God hath given to the sons of men to be exercised in it. He hath made everything beautiful in his time." We just sang that. "Also, he hath set the world in their heart so that no man can find out the work that God maketh from the beginning to the end. And I know that there is no good in them but for a man to rejoice and to do good in his life. And also that every man should eat and drink and enjoy the good of his labor. It is the gift of God. I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it. And God doeth it that man should fear before him. That which hath been is now, and that which is to be hath already been, and God requireth that which is past. Father, tonight we just pause to thank you, Lord, for such a wonderful day. A day in which we've had the opportunity to come together as the bride of Christ to worship you, not once, but twice. And Lord, we pray tonight that you would open not only your word, but we pray that you would open our hearts tonight to your word. Lord, we don't need just the mere words of a mortal man. We need the words from God Almighty. So Lord, we pray that you would speak. Anoint us, Lord, tonight, all of us, to hear what the Spirit says. And Father, for that we are eternally grateful tonight. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. We've all heard the phrase or even used it at some point in time, this phrase. Timing is everything. Whether we're telling a joke, and I don't know if you ever listened to somebody tell a joke and because of their timing it just wasn't funny. Then there are a lot of jokes that are not funny, but because of the person's timing, it is hilarious. I mean, really. And we know we've all been around, you know, times like that and with people like that. But I mean, whether it's telling a joke or investing all your money in the stock market is a timing thing. You got to get in at the right time and you got to know the right time to get out. Okay, because the whole purpose for you to invest your money is not to lose money, but to make money. So it is a timing thing. Okay, I know nothing about investing because I have nothing to invest but time. And that's usually the case. So, but you got to have something to invest if you're going to invest in the stock market. Cooking. You got to know the timing of cooking, ladies. Isn't that right? I remember I had an older gentleman in our church in Mississippi. I loved that joker. He was the first guy we met when we went to Mississippi the very first time. Old Brother Bell. And he always come up and tell me that on Sunday night service, Pastor, you preached too long this morning. I said, really? He said, yeah, wife's roast was dry. Timing is everything. But if we're dealing with people, timing is everything. I mean, there's a time that you can approach someone about something, and then there's a timing where you don't. And we, you know, we pretty much understand that in our everyday life. But timing is important in our spiritual life, just like it is in everyday life. And I think it's critical for us to live our life with an awareness of God's timing. God has got timing on everything. He's working on things. We can't see it. We may not be aware of it, but we do need to be aware that God is wanting to do a work in our lives, and timing is everything. Now, how do you say, well, how do you know that, preacher? Well, I mean, you and I would guess that God would want a young man to bring the children out of Israel. Bless you. But he didn't get a young man. He didn't get a 40-year-old man. He didn't even get an 80-year-old man. He had to wait till he turned 80 to bring him back to lead the people out of Egypt, out of bondage. We, in our worldly mindset, would say, hey, listen. You need a young guy to be able to lead a million plus people out of a land into another one. But I mean, that's just our mindset, but God's timing is perfect. He knew at just the right time for Moses when he was on the backside of the desert. He looks up into the mountain and sees something burning. He goes to investigate and finds a bush that's burning but not being consumed. It was timing. God is always working on timing. We need to be keenly aware of God's timing. There's times when people's lives that they have prayed for a spouse or a child to get saved. But you know, it may take that person 20, 30, 40, 50 years to pray that child into the kingdom. But it's all God's timing. It's going to happen in God's time and in God's way. So we need to make sure that we are aware of that in our own spiritual lives. And in this passage that we've read tonight, Solomon, I think, seems to tell us that life is really a matter of timing, because timing is everything. If we look down in these verses, we're going to see something, and it's a very key word. It's a key word called time. In the first 8 verses, he uses the word time 29 times. The first 8 the first eight verses, that's what we find. But I think that timing for us should be very evident, because, you know, we all have clocks, we all have watches. Doggone it, we got a cell phone that you got on your side that's got a clock on it. It's got a calendar. We got calendars for timing. I mean, what I try to do when somebody tells me something, what I want to do, so I'll make sure that I got the right time, I'll try to go ahead and put it on my calendar, my phone. But a lot of times your calendar doesn't tell you what time you're setting the time for. If it's an all-day event and you have not set a time, that thing will go off at 1 o'clock in the morning. I kid you not. I mean, I've looked over, my phone bill over just a flashing. And I'm like, what in the world? And look at it and it says, event for the day. So you have to make sure you set the time till you get the right timing on that. But we all have those things. But we have cell phones, calendars, computers, all this stuff. And so time and timing is everything. And timing, and if timing is everything, how should we live? And Solomon answers that question in these 15 verses, I think. So tonight we're going to look at time's up. Time's up. There's 4 things I want us to grasp from these 15 verses. I said, preacher, you preached for 45 minutes to an hour this morning, and you only had 3. It's all right. It's going to be okay tonight. Okay? If you're not sitting here listening to me preach, I mean, you're going to go home, get something to eat, lay back in your recliner, or go to bed. So you might as well sit and listen to me preach. Okay? All right. First thing we need to look at in verses 1 through 8. The first thing I think Solomon really wants us to get the idea is, in these first 8 verses, is that we need to expect change. Don't say that word in the church. We don't like change, preacher. But Solomon tells us we've got to expect change. Now, if you're like me, you're scared a lot of times in the mornings to look in the mirror because you're not the person you once were. I mean, some of us, our hair is no longer the same color as it was. And those are the blessed people, because all the others have lost their hair. Just say it. But I mean, just think about it. You know, we're not the same as we once were. We have changed over time. And Solomon makes this case for the brevity of life, and he just kicks it right off, you know. There's a time to be born, and there's a time to die. First sermon that I heard preached at a funeral one time was one that I just really got into, because I don't really get into funeral sermons that much. But I mean, I was listening to this guy doing this funeral, and I think I've even heard other preachers use the same idea, but it's about the dash between the 2 dates. You got a big birthday listed out over here. I'm going to use mine. April 2nd, 1966. Dash, date of birth, the day that you die, whatever month that is, day and year, that'll happen. And you got this little teeny tiny dash in the middle, and that is the brevity of life. How can we sum up a life in a dash? It's impossible for us, we think, but when we begin to look at the span of life on a chain or a rope, think about this. If we had a rope that, let's say, would reach from here to Australia. Everybody got that in your mind? Because Australia is a long ways away. Okay. We got this thing because it's almost 2,000 miles to Los Angeles, and then it's another 2,000 across the Pacific or thereabouts, so we're looking at approximately 4,000 miles. That's an estimation. Don't Google it and look at it and see. From Dublin to Sydney, Australia, okay? But we got that rope in our mindset, and we know how long that rope is. And the brevity of your life, when we compare it to eternity, is only about a half inch. Life is brief. And that's something that Solomon wants us to really let it sink in our heads, in our minds. But in these verses, as we have grown accustomed to previously, Solomon has brought judgments in on different topics. Right here, he brings no judgment in. There's no judgment whatsoever that he pins on the topic. He's just recording events that happen, as he says in this verse, under heaven. We remember when we think about the beginning chapters of Ecclesiastes, everything was life under the sun. But now he's talking about under heaven. All right, so it's a little bit different. But what we're seeing here is that he's telling us about the events of things that happen under heaven. But he also builds upon this word of appointed. Even though it never appears in the passage, the word appointed. There is a time to be born, an appointed time. Did you know that your birth didn't catch God off by surprise? It may have been a surprise to mom and dad, but it wasn't a surprise to God. Okay? And get this, because I'll be honest with y'all, my birth was a surprise. When you got a sibling 12 years older than you and 10 years older than you, surprise. That's a surprise. So, anyway, done lost my train of thought here. A time to be born and a time to die is where we are. So these are the first things in verse 2. We have a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck that which is planted. So not only has God appointed our birth dates and our dying date, these times are already appointed. He knows when all of it's going to happen, and none of this is going to catch him by surprise. But Solomon goes on to say that this is even true inside the plant world. God knows that when a plant is coming out of the seed, life begins in that plant life, and he also knows when it dies. Some plants have a very short lifespan. Other plants have a long lifespan. These trees that we're losing around the church right now have had a long, long lifespan. They've been here a while. Get in there and try to count some of them rings. Holy cow, them things been around as long as some of you. Really? But I think the emphasis that Solomon is making here is upon God's sovereignty over time. Folks, if we put God in any type of box, we have limited the limitless God. If God is limited by space or time, then he is not God. So he stands outside of time. Seeing time as we see it, he sees it all at once, where we can only see really the present. We can't see the past. We can look back at the past, at recorded events, and we can look towards the future hoping, but actually for us, all we have is the present. God has our past, present, and future all at one time before him. I know if you think like I do, that's just kind of hard to wrap your mind around. I can't wrap my mind around that. But that's what makes him God, because he is outside of time and space. For us, time is almost up. I was reading something some time back, and it said that every 8 seconds, someone dies. Every 8 seconds. That's pretty quick. Every 3 seconds, someone is born. Wow, Yeah, that's what I kind of thought. Life seems to be like a revolving door. I mean, we're here and then we're gone. And it's just a revolving door of life that continues on. But the same is true with the plant world as well. And we have various seasons of planting. Right now, I just believe without a shadow of a doubt, I have missed the season on broccoli. We ain't got no cold weather. Broccoli loves that cold weather, and I need to have cold weather. And I was, you know, on your phone, if you get the weather channel like I get on mine, I look on my phone and see what the temperature is a lot of time, and I pulled it up the other night before I went to bed. It was negative 42 degrees. And I got to looking at it, and I said, what in the world? The weather channel has lost their mind. But I had forgot that because I have another city on my phone that I like looking at, and it's Bartow, Alaska. That's my dream vacation. Bartow. And I was thinking, man, from negative 42 degrees, I've missed the planting season again. Now it's too cold to plant. But I just feel like, within myself, we're going to hopefully try to plant some broccoli, and maybe we can get it to grow. But, I mean, there's various seasons for planting. We're not going to go out and plant in the middle of November, December, and January tomatoes. We're just not going to do it. Now, if we keep having this global warming, we keep having that kind of stuff going on, we can plant in January. But it's not the season. God has set those seasons. He sets the boundaries and the times and the seasons, and they come and go quickly as He has ordained. So timing is everything. Look at the next verse. He says that there's a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up. Wait a minute, preacher, we stop. Right there. The Bible says, thou shalt not kill. Well, if we take that Hebrew word kill there in the Ten Commandments, you will understand it says that thou shalt not commit murder. There's a difference between killing and murder. But He tells us that there is a time to kill and a time to heal. And when we think about this thing about killing, we don't want to kill anyone. But there are times that it becomes necessary for a life to be taken. And God has placed it into the hands of civil governments that right to take the life, to avenge the blood of a life that was taken. God has placed it into their hands. Now, I got news for you. I'm not a mama bear, but you come and attack me and my family, you need to prepare to die. I love people, and God loves life. He has ordained life, and He thinks that all life is precious, and all life is special. But He also knows that there are sometimes evil in the world when another life tries to take the life of another. And I believe that God has given us the right to protect our families. In fact, he's told Paul in Romans that it is our responsibility to protect and watch over those who are unable to take care and protect themselves. I believe that. So don't you dare go off and say, that preacher at First Independent Methodist Church said it was okay to go and kill somebody and murder. The preacher has not said that at all. I'll get an email next week. I heard you said it's all right to murder. Man, I get a little fired up about that. Because I know God places high value on human life. But He said also, not only is there a time to kill, there's also a time to heal. And folks, I tell you, we can spend a long time on healing. It's not just the physical healing that He's talking about here. It's the emotional healing. And if you know anything about our nation right now, we are a nation in need of healing. We have so many things that have divided us, and there needs to be a national healing for America. You may need it in your family. There may be relationships at work or even at church that need to be healed. And I believe that this covers the whole scope of healing in our lives. So there's a time to do these things. He also said there's a time to tear down and a time to build up. Boy, we all know that, don't we? I mean, there's some buildings that are around a lot of times that it's time to tear it down. Amen, preacher. That's right. But there's also a time to build, okay? So let's keep moving on. There's a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Hold the boat. I do not have the gift of dance. It is not a pretty thing to see this person try to dance. Because if you ever get all this in one motion going, you cannot stop it. But I mean, Solomon's right. There is a time to weep. And there's times to weep when we're brokenhearted, when our heart is broken over a situation. And I was talking with somebody just this evening. They were talking about their situation, where they go, and it just broke my heart to see the struggle that is there. Not to a point of weeping yet, but folks, there are times that it brings us to our knees and weep. He talks about this a little bit later about mourning, but we know that when we're mourning the loss of someone, that weeping comes in. But always take heart, that's not a whole life of weeping. There is a time to weep, but then there's a time to laugh. I like to laugh. Sometimes I laugh to keep from weeping. And sometimes I laugh so hard I begin weeping. My kids apparently love it when I really get tickled and I start laughing, because I'll hit the floor like one of them dogs on television. I get to laughing so hard it's over. You know, it's done. You just can't do nothing. So anyway, I don't need to keep on that. Enough about me, right? It's not about me tonight. It's about the Word. So anyway, let's move on. Time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Now, I don't think it's time for me to dance just yet. I did a little bit of dancing in my teenage years, and thank God that time is gone. But I think what he's trying to tell us is that you and I, you know, we're going to encounter these negative and positive emotions and experiences in life. I know that I've had a lot of negative and positive experiences in my life, and with both brought the weeping or the laughter in my life. But one moment, I think we should be expecting that change occurs on a continual basis. You know, there is that time to weep, but there's that time to laugh. It's not, like I said, going to be just one season all your life. It's going to be a continual thing in our life that changes over and over and over. So one moment we're on the mountaintop, the next we're in the valley. We have to understand how we are to respond to the events in our life. We're not going to get to the mountaintop and weep and laugh when we're in the valley. We get to the mountaintop, we're going to be laughing. We get in the valley, we may weep. But to understand that there are these experiences in life that happens. And Solomon understands that. So it's important that we express the right thing at the right moment, because timing is everything. Now, check out these next couple of ones that he mentions here. There's a time to throw stones and a time to gather stones. What in the world is he thinking? When was the last time you threw stones? When was the last time you gathered stones? Ain't been a long time for me, brother. I have got out and collected rocks sometimes. Anytime we got ready when we were over in, what's the name of that state on the West Coast? California. Yes, when we were over there for that wedding, we were getting ready to come back. And between Beth and Thomas and myself, we had collected, I don't know, a bunch of rocks. Because out there on the West Coast, they don't have seashells. They got rocks in the water. So anyway, we collected all these rocks, and I was thinking, we'll never get these things on the plane to fly back. Thank God for Ted and Don, Ann and Vicky. They had their vehicle, so we put them all in their vehicle to bring back with them. Huh? But I mean, you think about these stones. But what Solomon was saying, when in that day when they were out getting, preparing a field to plant, they would have to remove the stones, and a lot of them would throw the stones out of the way and just toss them out to the side. And when he was talking about gathering, the only time you gathered stones, when you wanted to build a wall or build a house, you had to have these stones. So there's a time to cast stones or throw stones, and there's a time to gather them. And that's what Solomon is talking about. Sometimes you and I, it may not be stones, but you and I, while we're going through this life, we may have to pick some trash up out of our way and toss it. So we can take that to a little bit of a spiritual level for us in this life. But he said there's a time to embrace and a time to shun embracing. And that's one thing that I was thinking about this past week when I read that passage. A lot of times, you know, you get out in public and you want to snuggle up with your honey. When I try to do that with Beth, Beth said, now is not the time. Because there is a time to embrace, and then there's a time not to embrace. And she keeps me corrected on that, when the right time is. All right, so anyway, I'm not going to spend too much time on that right there. We're going to move on. Our time is fleeting again. There is a time to get, he says, and a time to loose, a time to keep, and a time to cast away. And I think Solomon here is trying to get us to understand that we can get things that we need, and that's good and okay, just like they did in those days. But this is what I like about it. Catch this. When he says it's time, there's a time that to get and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to cast away, Solomon says it's okay to have a yard sale. That's what God spoke to me in that passage. It's okay to have a yard sale. We do not need to be collecting stuff just for the sake of collecting. I've got so much junk, and I didn't say my wife. I said, I got so much junk I need to get rid of. I don't have enough room in my house to go and get the other lawnmower that's in the shop. I probably got $10 million worth of... No. The fee you got to pay for not picking it up. Whatever that fee is. Storage fee, thank you. Yeah. That's what I always tell people when it's at the shop. They say, you know, hey, I need this head built. I said, okay. It'd sit on the shelf a week. A second week, they call and say, is that thing ready? I said, been ready for 2 weeks. How much is it? I said, originally it was this, but now you got 2 weeks storage fee. So we're going to add $25 a day storage fee to that cylinder head. They're like, what? I said, I'm just kidding, all right? But it stays here much longer. We're going to have to start adding storage fee. But see, I mean, I don't have no place to put it. I need to have a place to put it. So I need to get rid of some of this other stuff. And God just told me in his word, it's okay to have a yard sale. Because there's a time to get and there's a time to lose. Then he says there's a time to rent and a time to sow. Now, don't think he's talking about renting a house, okay? He's talking about a time to rip your clothes off. We know when the people in that day mourned, they rent their clothes. They tore their clothes off. And he says there's a time to do that, but there's also a time to put it all back together, okay? And these are all things that we need to understand tonight. And then he goes on to say this, and here's another place. And I have this one really marked in my Bible. I don't know why God wanted me to mark this, but apparently I marked it some time ago. He said there was a time to keep silent. There's a time to speak. Yeah, that hurts. This is what we need to understand tonight, church. If God wanted you to speak twice as much as you listen, he'd have gave you two tongues and one ear. Let that sink in. But instead, he gave you two ears and one tongue. So we should listen twice as much as we speak. Well, preacher, why don't you practice that? But get this one. And because this is just a contradiction in God's word, there's a time to love and there's a time to hate. What? Jesus told us to, you know, that makes the Old Testament wrong. Really? Did you know that there is things God hates? God hates sin. You and I should hate sin. Sin should just turn our bellies. So there is a time to love and there's a time to hate. There's a time to love people, and we're to love people. If they're in the midst of sin, we love those people. But we want to hate that sin. We want to love people even though they may do evil things. We're still to love. It doesn't mean now if you come up and want to do some evil to my family that you're not going to catch some repercussions. Because the Bible said there's a time to kill. Just say it. And I think we need to grab that. But I know that Solomon understands this, that there's a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. When a nation is attacked, they have the right to go to war. When one of the allies of that nation is attacked, that is like an attack on that nation. So we have an opportunity or the right to go to war. But we always want and should seek for peace. Peace first. Seek it as much as we can. But if the other side will not absolutely let us have peace, then war is inevitable. All right, let's look at verses 9 through 11 real quickly. We read these just a moment ago, but what I want you to know about these few verses, 9 through 11, is not only should we accept change or expect change, we should also accept limitations. Did you know tonight that you are limited? Yeah, we're limited tonight. We have so many questions in this life. Why was I born this way? Why could not have God have given me a body that has black hair, no gray mixed in, a six-pack instead of a keg, muscles in my leg instead of it all being flab? Why did God make me this way? Why did my parents treat me that way when I was younger? Why am I missing out on this or that? And I think the problem tonight is that we focus our attention on the wrong thing. We focus it on the wrong thing, and Solomon, I think, tries to get us to understand that when we look at a cocoon of a butterfly before it becomes a butterfly, we see that old ugly, nasty-looking cocoon hanging in the tree limb. It's not a pretty sight. We look at the cocoon, and what does God look at? He looks at the butterfly on the other side. So you see, we have to change our perception and the way we look at things. We see the painful process. God sees the value of what's being produced. It is painful now, but when we come out on the other side, that's what God is seeing. He is producing a valuable thing inside of our lives. We see today, God sees forever. We get caught up in the wrapping, God sees the gift. And it just continues on, that type of cycle. We look at the external things. God is constantly looking at the internal things. And He makes everything beautiful in His time. That's what He says. He even makes our losses and our failures, our brokenness, our battles, our broken dreams, our heartaches, and the list goes on. Whatever it is we're going through, He makes everything beautiful in His time. Without Him, life is really purposeless for us. It profits us nothing. It's even pointless at times. But with Him, it will ultimately make sense for us. And Solomon says we need to expect change and accept limitations. 12 and 13 is what I really wanted to look at tonight for me, but I'm going to sum this up for you very quickly. I know this is not for y'all tonight. This is for me, okay? So you don't have to write the third point down, but it's very simple. Enjoy life. Solomon says the greatest response to this life is to make the most of it. We only have one life to live. There are a lot of people who believe in reincarnation. Folks, I got news for you. You ain't coming back as something else. Okay? When you gone, you gone. That's the bottom line. So enjoy life by including God in all that you do. Everything. And I believe that a biblical faith is a call to joy. I read a passage early this morning where the psalmist said, "Restore the joy of my salvation." That one verse just spoke volumes to me this morning. But biblical faith is a call to joy. And we can make the most out of our days here on earth. And very quickly, let's give you the summary of verses 14 and 15. We're to fear God, Solomon says in these verses. I think Solomon is saying that God's work is permanent and complete. It all is. Everything he does is all inspiring. But we have to remember that when somebody says that we're to fear God, it does not mean this paralyzing terror. Okay? That's not what the word fear there means when God tells us to fear him. But what it is a commitment of total trust in believing in God. And I don't know about you, but if you ever stood at the foot of a large mountain, you look at that thing and you're like, wow, that thing is just humongous and it's powerful. No, God wants us to have that same sense with him. We look at him and say, wow, it's just inspiring. And that's what God's really wanting from you and I. And when we do, then we'll just, I believe that when we stand in awe of who God is and all that he is, we will understand just how temporary this life is in contrast to eternity. The rope stretching from here to Australia, a half inch is our life. When we stand and see eternity with God's eyes, man, I tell you what. And there was something that's really interesting in verse 11. I back up it right quick. I wanted to make note of this because it says, Solomon said, "He hath made everything beautiful in his time. Also, he hath set," in the King James, it says the world, but that word is translated eternity. God has set into the hearts of men and women, boys and girls, eternity. So that we know there's something out there. And for us to stop a lot of heartaches, we can stop trying to put the things of the world in that vacuum and just understand that God has set eternity within us. We know something else is there, and we need to hang on to it. It'll sure help us in this life. So Solomon gives us some pretty sound wisdom. Accept change, accept limitations, enjoy life, and fear God. And I hope that we'll do that in our everyday lives. Amen.
Hello, I'm Pastor Paul Brown with First Independent Methodist Church here in Dublin. We would like to extend a special invitation for you to join us every Sunday at 10 a.m. for Sunday school, 11 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. for worship service. We also have two Bible studies every Wednesday at 3 and 7 p.m. At First Independent Methodist Church, you'll be a part of a caring and loving church family who want to share the love of Christ with you. We have something going on for all ages, whether it be our children's church, our wonderful youth program, Sisters in Christ, our men's ministry, or one of our Bible studies. We are so excited about what God is doing at FIMC. Also, please tune in to our services every Saturday night at 8 p.m. here on TV 35. We look forward to seeing you this Sunday at First Independent Methodist Church on Claxtonbury Road and Cardinal Drive. I pray that you will come and be a part of our family this week.